Hello and welcome. Hi, I'm Cliff Groh. I'm chair of Alaska Common Ground. And we're here for this scheduled event, scheduled to go as long as 4:30 if there's interest. There are three men on the stage, Gunnar Knapp, Michael Chambers, and Paul D. Kendall. So we're going to start soon, and they will have some presentations and some questioning among these three men, questions and answers, the three men on the stage. And then at various points, we'll have opportunities for questions from the audience. So we're going to start with Gunnar Knapp. Could you introduce yourself and give a brief opening statement?
I'm a director and also a professor of economics at the UAA Institute of Social and Economic Research, or ICER. I do a lot of things there, but one of the things I've been doing over the past 2 years is spending a lot of time going around the state talking about Alaska's fiscal situation. I've given quite a lot of presentations about the situation, and I've titled those presentations Alaska Fiscal Facts and Choices. And what I've been trying to do in those presentations is to just inform the state's discussion of our fiscal situation by describing basic facts of our state's revenues, spending, and savings, and the nature of the issues that we face. What I've tried to emphasize in those presentations, what I'm doing in those presentations, and in general what I've been trying to do in my work related to this area, is to help inform the conversation, but not to advocate for any particular choice, just so that people can have a discussion and just sort of understand the basic facts that we're dealing with. I've also emphasized that the issues are really complex, so it's not easy to, in 10 minutes or half an hour or 3 hours, it's not easy to sort of summarize everything that's actually relevant to that discussion. The discussion is always bigger than whatever you're able to fit in. About 6 weeks ago, there was one of these meetings was held here in this room. It was sponsored by UAA and I guess the Rasmussen Foundation. And there were a lot of people here, and during the sort of questions that followed, Mr. Paul Kendall stood up and asked me a question that read something the effect of the following. Are you willing to have an on-camera, unedited, frank, open, honest, fearless, unhurried, challenging, probing, unrehearsed, reviewing, point-counterpoint, addressing, redressing, multifaceted discussion with divergent and opposing aspects of Alaska current and future public and private infrastructures of revenue, spending, diversified economies, etc.? And he followed up by saying basically that he felt a little frustrated, and I can relate to this, that in a lot of these debates or discussions that are happening around the state, a bunch of talking heads get up on stage like me and talk, and people in the audience like him get 10 seconds to ask a question, which maybe somebody gives a flippant 15-second answer to, and the question never engages the topic of interest. So he was interested in a chance to have a more detailed, significantly more detailed, longer follow-up about aspects of this that were important to him and others. And so I answered, well, yeah, I'm willing to have such a discussion. And so we scheduled it, and we had one. We had a first discussion about 2 weeks ago in this room, and this is a follow-up. And so we had quite a long and wide-ranging discussion between Paul, me, and a number of people who are in the audience who asked questions at various times. So, and this is a continuation. So I guess the final thing I'll say is this is Paul's event, I'm here to try to respond and participate in whatever way I usually can. And I'm delighted he's also invited Michael Chambers here today, whom I'm meeting for the first time. Who I'm sure can enrich our discussion.
Paul D. Kendall, would you introduce yourself?
Yes, my name is Paul, middle initial D. Kendall. I'm a political and energy activist, and I've been watching some of these presentations by Mr. Gunnar on several events. He's done very well. They've been very well done, but they seem to be the tip, or they seem to be moving a message with a limited direction. And it's very difficult to be able to access many of the people that are moving the message or their mission. And in challenging Mr. Gunnar Knapp in this room, he accepted the challenge. And I didn't realize at the time exactly what that meant, but you should always be careful of the things you ask for, you might get them. But when we engaged here, we both agreed it would be an exploratory moment. And it has been for us. And I've been a little concerned about the engagement in the sense that it had to be beneficial to all parties. And after our last meeting, it seemed to me that there was a little lacking in being able to move the message. We used no presentation. We just had hard or not hard. We had frank discussions for 2 hours. And I think they were very frank. And here we are today. We're going to try to refer to a couple of slides. In the meantime, I was concerned about my ability to participate in a discussion with a man of Mr. Knapp's caliber. And with such a large, representing such a large institutional body with such great capabilities. So I called the Elastic Forum, Alaska Institute Forum, what's David Boyle?
Alaska Policy Forum.
Alaska Policy Forum, to ask him if he'd like to participate. And the reason for that is because Gunnar gave me great latitudes. As you said, as you just saw there, he presented as my moment. So that puts a lot of responsibility. So I reached out for a greater member of the public to participate in this in the event that my views were too narrow and isolated. And the Alaska Institute for Foreign Policy, they recommended Mr. Chambers here. And I contacted him and asked if he'd like to participate for, say, 45 minutes for a better, wider view or input for the public. And then I called Mr. Knapp and asked if it was okay, and he said yes. So that kind of brings us up to date. Everything that Mr. Knapp has said is correct. And I hold him in a high degree of respect at this time and at this place, and that's well meant. So, and then Mr. Chambers, if you'd like to, or Gunnar, I still convey to Gunnar a role of seniority here and professionalism and other aspects. But I guess if you want to introduce yourself, and for 45 minutes, it's 2:41 or something, and you and Gunnar have a primary talk, and I'll try to interrupt if I get a chance. But so
there you go. Well, thank you very much for having me. Here I came to Alaska in 1975. My mother was a pipeliner, so I'm a pipeline brat. My first introduction to Alaska was Paxson, Alaska. I lived there for 5 years. And during that period of time, I attended the University of Colorado in Boulder. So that was quite an event to go from Paxson to Boulder. So I got a degree both in fine arts and in art education. I became a school teacher in Delta Junction for a period of time. And then I left that profession for my love profession, which is a professional artist. And I function as a professional artist here in Alaska for 35 years. About 6 years ago, I had an awakening. I found myself complaining but not being involved. And I said, you know, that's not fair. That's not right. I think that citizens, when you're on political vacation, so is your liberty. So I got involved, and I've always been a registered libertarian. I've been a libertarian since 1977, registered by Dick Randolph, which is the godfather of the Libertarian Party. And I ascended to the ranks of the chair of the Alaska Libertarian Party. And then I, 3 years ago, started an organization called United for Liberty, which has 24 groups in Alaska, parties and groups, like the Alaska Republican Party, Alaska Constitution Party, the Alaska Libertarian Party, Alaska Independence Party, Alaska Veterans Party, and then I think about approximately 20 other groups. We came together this last year that we felt that ICER had done a wonderful job with regard to setting a target out there of sustainability and some ideas and recommendations. But we felt that we needed to get into the basis of what the state was doing and where they were spending the money, and to go in there in a forensic study of finding out exactly where the money is in fact going. And so through that, I formed a citizens group of 15 different citizens group, and we turned over to the legislature in February the largest citizens book that volunteers that's ever been given to the state of Alaska. It's 96 pages. It basically goes through every department, and looks for where the money is being spent and the inefficiencies there. Next year, I hope to follow it up with more inefficiencies, because as anybody knows, when you are involved with government, there's a tremendous amount of inefficiencies there, and there's not a whole lot of methodology that's come to bear with regard to evaluating that inefficiency. So we're going to have our work cut out for us. I will clearly say that this book wouldn't exist if it wasn't for the work of Dr. Goldsmith and Dr. Gunnar Knapp from ICER. They're more or less our professors, and we're the students that have broken off of that and gone into a more in-depth study with regard to where the state of Alaska is going with their money and what is there. And then also the politics. How do you interface? And I'm sure that I'm going to get into with Gunnar here with regard to how you take this information and interface it with the legislature. So thank you again very much for having me here.
Well,
why don't you go ahead?
Yeah, what?
Why don't you go ahead, Gunnar?
Well, no, I think it's a wonderful introduction, and so I'll turn it over to you, gentlemen, to start the discussion. I might simply comment that I haven't had a chance to study it yet, but somebody was kind enough to email me this publication, and I printed it out, and I said I got to read this. Like you said, you went through all the different parts of state government and talked about sort of where you saw savings as possible, so I commend that effort. And the it reminds me, I was part of I sort of participated kind of a little bit in an effort on that an organization called Commonwealth North had to sort of try to understand the state's operating budget, just the operating budget, and they weren't as comprehensive, they didn't put as much work in as this, but they had some people come in and give presentations and go over different parts, and it very quickly got bogged down in complexity, because there's 17 different departments, and then some of these departments are huge, like the Department of Health and Social Services, just agency after agency after agency within there, or even, you know, Department of Transportation, you know, many different sub-agencies, the Marine Highway, the aviation part, the roads and planning and so on, and not to mention another agency that we're physically sitting in here, the university, hugely complicated. So it's really, I found it really hard as an interested citizen and supposedly a professional researcher just outside these agencies to figure out what exactly they did, or if you read that a firefighting station somewhere in Galena or whatever costs this much, how am I supposed to have a clue on whether that's an essential function of state government that's incredibly efficient, or if that's some totally unnecessary thing that is triple staffed? I just had no way of knowing. So that was my reaction to this. So I was looking forward to reading this with interest.
Sure.
But then the other question is, well, how do you get the legislature? If you believe that that the 100 or so things that you've laid out here would be sensible places to cut, how do you get the legislature to actually act on that?
Okay, well, that's two questions. That's probably about four or five, but let me answer the two overriding questions. One, you're never going to be legislatively effective until you establish relationships. If you're just trying to work with the legislature because you're a citizen and you want to get involved and you want to send them an email and you want to and you want to write them a letter or you want to contact them at a town hall, that's one level of involvement. But the biggest level of involvement is to actually establish relationships. I take great pride in the fact that my cell phone here has probably about 45 of the legislators' cell phones in it. So I can actually, in fact, text them on the floor or get in touch with them, or they get in touch with me. And I think that that's because I've taken the last 3 years and established those relationships. And a lot of those relationships aren't necessarily political. You might be out fishing with them, or you might be out snow machining. You know, they're human beings, and you have to establish those relationships around that. Once you have those relationships established, then they're going to listen to you in a more specific way, and they're going to reach out to you. And so I suggest any citizen that wants to get involved with politics or with trying to move the legislature, you have to take the time, and it takes, you know, it could take 2-3 years. But if you don't start today, you're 2 or 3 years behind. So if you want to be a citizen activist, that's the first question. The second thing is that then in doing research, you've got to make sure that the research is going to be pertinent and specific and something that can assist them. Probably one of the most important things in here is an appendix in here. And why that's important is because as legislators, they prioritize. They are in different committees, subcommittees, and things of that nature. And so they want to go to the appendix and find out exactly what committees they're on and what recommendations you're giving. So you have to give them direction in an influential way. The other thing is you don't demand from legislators. That's the worst thing that you could do. It turns them off in a heartbeat. When I turned in this book to them, it was all recommendations, and I've gotten tremendous feedback from both the left and right. I could care less whether a person's left or right. I care about them being Alaskan and doing the right thing. But in this forensic study, I will tell you that I have found some really interesting things. The state of Alaska, we actually fund 21,000, or we have 21,400 employees in the state of Alaska. We fund 26,000. So the immediate question is what are $275 million floating around in the state of Alaska in slush funds in every one of the departments? Because that's what's going on. I will tell you that we did an extreme forensic studies of the Department of Public Safety. I have one of the people that worked on that was a state trooper for 12 years. And the state of Alaska has had over 80 positions, a state trooper positions funded, that are there have been no personnel there. And so you hear at the state level and you hear at the city level that we need more public safety and everything. Why are we funding 80 positions that are approximately $180,000 that are being funded and those positions have never been filled? Over the last 10 years, there have been approximately 80 positions that have not been filled. Why is it that a VPSO program, which is the Village Police Officer program, costs about, it's around $65,000 for a village police officer. That's what their salary is. Why does it cost the state of Alaska $214,000 per individual slot? Because the administrative fees are outrageous. And this is what you find when you walk into these forensic studies. You find that we've spent $73 million on the aerospace industry. What for? You find out that we've spent millions of dollars on the barley farms in Delta Junction and on the dairy farms valley.
If I might, where are you going with this?
Literally, it's real important for the citizens in the state of Alaska to know where your funds are being spent and what is being used. Because if the citizens are not aware of how the money is being spent, then when we talk about, and the ICER plan talks about sustainability, my question is, what are you sustaining? At what level? We're on the same sheet of music with regard to that we should lower the footprint of government to what we can afford, not just what we want. We do that within our families, and ICER has put out those targets that I'm very respectful of. But once you have a target out there, you have to understand, what are we funding? Look in there and see what we're funding. If you're going to call that sustainability, I have to question that, because I think that you have to look inside. As an example, in school districts, we have 57 school districts in the state of Alaska. We have 4 school districts in Prince Wales Island. We have 1 school district, Pelican School District, that has 11 students in it and a professor, or excuse me, not a professor, sorry, a superintendent. So when you look at the figures, you have to ask yourself, is the state of Alaska and is our representative spending the money correctly? Or is it just about pandering to the public sector? Because that's what I come from, is I come from the private sector. In the state of Alaska, if we look at the private sector, we are not going to go anywhere until we start developing the private sector. We have a highly developed public sector. We have the largest public sector of any state in the union. But we do not have a private sector. And if you go to any state in the union and you tell them to function as a private sector on 1% of their land, I would suggest to you that you'd have a hard time. And we are here in the state of Alaska, the largest state in Alaska, and the private sector is functioning off of less than 1% of this land. There's something wrong with this picture.
Well, and if I might interject here for just a moment now. Now, when I challenged Gunnar, it was because he's moving the message. Mr. Knapp and Mr. Groh and some other individuals in this community, what they're doing is they're packaging the message and delivering it. The presentations he's making, there's nothing wrong with them. They're clear-minded and they're informative and have some specificity, but they have no drill down. They have no ability to dig in and to get traction for the reconstruction. And I take great difference with his presentation. And in the last meeting, I think I admonished you, respectfully, of course, and we've been very respectful, but Mr. Knapp has been anyway. But the point is that he has a deeper obligation to this community, this state, and a sense of moral foundation to look at these things, which I think is what you're bringing up, Mr. Chambers. You're bringing up a greater I have a level of discontent, but you have a level of factual references that are, quite frankly, unacceptable in their accountability. And so in addressing Gunnar, some of the people in the last meeting mentioned that we were here to attack Gunnar. And I told Mr. Knapp, it isn't that I'm attacking him. He's the only one on the point that's accountable. I have Vince Beltrami trying to get a hold of him and some of these other people have hard discussions and they just simply ignore you. And that leaves Mr. Knapp out on the front end. And in some ways he should be because he's the intelligentsia of our community. He's the very creme de la creme, if you will, of the point of the people we put our greatest dollars and trust into. Now, this is your time, but I'm trying to...
Sure, no problem. I just want to emphasize, and then I'll turn it back to Gunnar, is that I think it's really inappropriate to talk about income tax, sales tax, capturing the permanent fund. I think those are premature statements, because when you look at the budget and you look at the excess of government spending and you look in there, I would highly suggest that we need to clean up government and get it back to its original purpose first before we ever even consider taking the citizens' money. Because taking the permanent fund dividend is certainly taking money right from the private sector. And that the permanent fund dividend is our resource that was given to us because our allodial title was taken away. We don't have subsurface rights. So the permanent fund dividend is actually a royalty check in lieu of us owning our property correctly. And so anytime that the government is talking about that or incorporating income tax, I just think it's premature. I think that there should have been a definite forensic study with regard to the budget first before they start incorporating any of those kinds of revenue grabs, because I truly believe all those revenue grabs are for one thing, and that is to maintain special interest. And so I'll turn it back over to Gunnar, also want to speak about the university because I have a pretty substantial background
if I could,
there.
If I could interrupt just for a moment again there, Gunnar, because it is my show, right? anyway, and what he just said there lifts the lid on the cauldron. You lift that lid up, and my God, the level of complexity that you engage is just unbelievable. It's like a box of bugs trying to run at one time. It's unbelievable what we get into when we open that up. And yet the reason we do is because we've not been responsible in our leadership of Alaska and where we're going for the future. And when you take all of that, geez, what a bite. It is a hell of a bite. And our legislature's hanging out in Juneau in secret meetings. And this is an accomplished man and a true professional, and I happen to be part of the indentured servants, if you will, are just very upset, okay? But now I'll let you go back to where you're at. I'm just trying to get the layout of where we're all at here. But
So let me just try to respond to several things you guys have said. So it's clear that you and certainly a huge number of citizens of Alaskans probably, perhaps a large majority, strongly feel that the state is spending way too much money, okay? And then a lot of people, very few people have gone through the exercise that you have of studying the entire budget and sort of saying, and here we've gone through it, and here's 100 different ways in which we think it's too much and things that aren't needed or whatever. More often, what I see is people are frustrated about some particular kind of thing which they think is wasteful. They say, oh, the legislative office building, or they say, the legislative travel or legislative, you know, legislators' retirement. For some reason, they often mention the legislature, but they come in with or the university or whatever. They talk about different parts of it, but here's what I've observed, and this is, it's not just regular people saying this. The people that are saying that we're spending too much includes the people, the most powerful people in the legislature. Like, they came into this session and they said, this is, we're spending too much. We're, state government's bloated and so on. I mean, there were a number of people that, that are sort of in the majority leadership in the Senate and the House. And then they started their legislative session and they started working on the budget. And they made some cuts to the state budget, but they weren't a huge amount. You know, probably one of the biggest cuts came with the, you know, with the university, where the cut was proposed to cut the general fund budget from $350 million to $300 million. It's probably one of the biggest, but a lot of the agencies had very little change. So I'm, so there I find the situation that even though people say, well, we ought to cut the budget, they don't. And as a result, we're left with this huge deficit. And other people say, well, people say, well, we don't want to raise new revenues, we don't want to tax, we don't want to touch dividends because we think the problem is on the spending side. So then we don't get any new money and we don't cut, and then we have a big deficit, and then the savings are drawn down. And I think, well, where is this going?
Do you know why that is?
Well, I mean, I think I'm an economist, I'm not a politician. And so I inform me.
Okay, well, I will. I clearly believe that what's going on at the legislature is kabuki theater. And that's why you have that exact situation here where nobody wants to have revenues, but nobody wants to cut, because rather the majority is saying that they'd like to cut, look at their actions, okay? And very clearly, their actions are indicating that, one, there is a substantial amount of organizations out there, whether it be Plan for Alaska or Alaska's Future or the First National Bank of Alaska or whatever. There's substantial money folks out there that are very much interested in taking the permanent fund dividend. And because they are a special interest, they want that money to maintain government at 5.2 billion, which is, by the way, only the state expenditures. We have federal expenditures too. Our actual budget is $13 billion. We have $8 billion of federal money coming in each year, but just looking at the 5.2, they want to sustain that. Well, there's unions, there's these rich folks that are very much interested in taking the permanent fund dividend, and so legislators are interested in one thing, and that's being reelected. And that's just a reality. And so they're trying to balance, well, let's see, I'm going to have the rich people after me, and they're going to find somebody to run against me, and they're going to fund their campaign, and I'm going to be out of the place. Or I've got the citizens over here that want to maintain and keep their permanent fund dividend. So do I go with the citizens, or do I go with the rich folks who want me to take the permanent fund? And so what they're doing is they're basically playing kabuki theater until June 1st, when is the deadline for anybody to file to run against them, and then you'll have a budget come out. So we have a special session right now. We're paying $26,000 a day so they can play kabuki theater until after the deadline where they can make decisions, because they don't want their decisions to be held against them. And you can rest assured after June 1st, you'll find a budget that will be coming out. So those are the things that are happening. It's an unfortunate situation because it's politics. And unfortunately, politics has those kinds of things. The reason why I'm here is because there's people here in the audience, and if I wake up two people or three people or four people to understand and to be more involved, that not just complaining about the Legislative Information Office, but to actually get involved, because we owe one thing, and that is we own this future to our children. And if we can't fix this situation now, then we're just laying down. And to me, I have a child. In fact, she just graduated from USC with full honors just a week ago on a full ride scholarship, academically started here at UAA. And so I owe my entire life to making sure that she has a better life. And I want her to be able to come back here to Alaska and to live in Alaska in a free society, and not one that's just governed by government, government excess, and that's what's going on.
And if I might, now, your time with him is, like I said, 45 minutes, so I'm going to participate very little if I can, but in my world, 98% of all problems are leadership-based, period. A good leader either sees the problems coming, prepares for them, or he resolves them on the spot, or he gathers his people up to tell them of something that's unprecedented and we all need to get together. What we're dealing with is symptom after symptom after symptom after symptom. We have no leadership, and in my opinion, it's Juno. You have to disconnect Juno. Now, I'm going to stop there, but I'm trying to show the diversity of opinions that are here, and there are a ton more out there, but there's no public forum. They're all closed moments. And so this is Mr. Knapp showed the leadership qualities to engage, and that's why we're here. But I'm trying to help. Yeah,
I think that somehow, and this is the problem we face certainly nationally as well, people are really dissatisfied with the apparent inability of government to change the society in a way that they want it to be. And they, you know, you use the term kabuki theater, but whatever, it all seems to be all show and not getting where they want. I think there's another part to it, which is that different citizens have different groups in the society, and it's not just the, you know, rich people, although I totally get that there are very powerful lobbying interests and powerful moneyed interests that come in and argue for particular things, but you also have things that sort of large numbers of people support in government spending, not necessarily, but I think, you know, school funding is one of them. So there's large numbers of people that say, if somebody comes and says we should cut school funding, then they, it's not just rich lobbyists, come and say, we don't want that. We don't want that cut. And then so the legislators who are trying to get elected are sort of stuck between the people like yourselves who are saying, we're dissatisfied, we see waste. We see this isn't necessary, the, you know, they mentioned the school district in wherever, Pelican or whatever, and all that stuff. And then other people who are out there, I just saw it the other day on, you know, TV, a big demonstration against a proposed cut to education, mobilized immediately as soon as it was proposed. So I guess what I'm saying is we don't, no matter how strongly we feel about something, we don't necessarily get our way.
But Gunnar, those people have conflicts of interest directly. This is what we're talking about. The feeding off the permanent fund, the oil money, is just hideous. These people have conflicts of interest. We're taking testimony representation from people that should have to declare that right off the top.
It's unbelievable. Yeah, but let's, so I get that.
But
on the oil issue, I get that. But what about, you know, and I'm using the example of the schools, not to advocate for school funding, but to try to sort of convey what I'm talking about, the political problem. There are people out there, and it's not just rich people, it includes, you know, various kinds of parents or whatever, who go out there and say, don't cut the schools. And they think that, you know, they think, don't cut the schools. And so then there are other people who say, we can't afford these super expensive schools. And so we somehow, you know, what are we gonna do? All we can do is you can try to vote in people that believe like you do, that will actually, if you think the school's funding is too much, then reduce it. But otherwise, we're just sort of stuck. That's the problem with a democracy. You end up, sometimes you elect people and you don't get your way. They don't, or the other people elect some. I don't know, but it seems to be a time of particular frustration for people in Alaska and people across the country, that they're not getting their way. And nobody seems to be listening, and the politicians don't achieve what large numbers of people seem to want.
Well, so yeah, I want to address that education issue, because I do have an education degree and I've spent some time in that field. So today in Anchorage, the Anchorage School District, the administrative cost is 42% is the administrative cost. So I'm an advocate of lowering the administration and sending the money back to the classroom where it belongs. I think that all too many times when you fund education and it goes to the district first, the district is going to take care of themselves first, and then they're going to take care of the classroom second. And I think that's backward. I would highly suggest that it would be in the better interest of the citizens of Alaska and the students of Alaska that the money goes directly to the schools, and that there's a percentage that's set aside for administration. If you look across the state of Alaska...
Just to explain, what do you mean by directly to the schools? So how would that work?
Well, as an example, they fund charter schools directly, okay? Why couldn't they fund public education directly? It goes directly to the school system, and there's a percentage that's set aside for the administration. So right now, there's no particular percentage, and if you look at the school systems, it's inculcated with a tremendous amount of administrative costs. One, and the second thing is that I'm sure you're probably familiar that the University of Alaska is a university lands grant, it's federal lands grant university. We have, we're number 48 in the nation with regard to receiving lands grants. It was taken off the table at statehood, and we had a land grant given to us in 1915 from Judge Wickersham up in, he was the territorial governor. But we only have two states in the nation that have less, is Hawaii. And Hawaii has less land grants because all of Hawaii is state-owned. There's not a federal government in Hawaii. And number two is Delaware. And then third is Alaska. We had our land grant taken back away from us, and we've only acquired it over the years through natural endowments and things of that nature. So we have a very small federal land grant, and when you're talking about looking at all the others. So I would suggest that the University of Alaska would be better served to work with the delegation from the U.S. Congress with regard to getting, demanding the equal footing of our state and getting university land grants. Alaska Pacific University, they utilize their land grants quite well, and they've lowered their tuition. The Mental Health Trust has utilized theirs. But the university system in the University of Alaska has not done what I would consider a yeoman's job with regard to developing the resources that are available for the land grants. Now, I want them expanded, and I have an excellent idea that I think is going to interest you, is the 1002 area of ANWR. I would like to see it identified as a university land grants for K through 12 and university. And the reason why that would be so popular is because at the federal government, you need the support of the Democrats. And I think Democrats would support a university land grant with the 1002 ANWR area that hasn't been opened up for 30 years because they're not directing that information correctly. And I'm working right now with Senator Sullivan in recognizing that. And if you had a university land grant, you wouldn't have teachers and the NEA and all that going down to Juneau. You'd have them coming over here to the Board of Regents. And it would be like an educational endowment, much like the permanent fund, set up where we could actually tap into ANWR and use it as an educational endowment and free up two educational programs, the university program here and also K through 12. And you could bind them together, and then you'd have a better weaving of the university with high school students. So that's something that I'm advocating and working on very clearly right now. So I guess to sum it up, I think that too many times we're looking at education, we keep doing all the wrong things. I think it's time to take off those glasses and start looking at a different perspective, and I certainly believe that the university land grants is extremely important with regard to developing a self-sustaining university. So,
and now let me, if I can, put another layer on that. Now, this is I'm not sure if I should get into the discussion or not, because the two of you I see as a different viewpoint here, Gunnar. So you be sure and let me know. Right.
Well, I was just going to respond briefly
go ahead. I apologize.
To what he said. So first of all, I mean, it's a long, long time, decades old strategy of Alaskans to look to the federal government to send us money to help with things, and certainly I think the university would welcome anything the congressional delegation could do that would provide sort of a more and more stable funding to the university, such as some kind of expanded land grant program. I think it's a politically very interesting idea, the idea of tying ANWR development to something that the liberals that have traditionally lined up with the environmentalists that have opposed opposed opening ANWR. It put a little fire under them, make them a little schizophrenic, perhaps, if they sort of were faced to choose, forced to choose between protecting, you know, preventing development of that area or potentially coming up with funding. But that's sort of in the area of federal politics. Again, I would simply say that somebody who's frustrated with government spending too much in some other state might look and say, there you go again, you know, giving away money to, you know, Alaska. And so what's good for us, other people might not necessarily like.
But they're only allowing us to develop the resource that we have.
Right.
And the 1002 area is laid aside as an economic interest zone.
Yeah. Anyway, that was my only comment on that.
Mm-hmm. Well, if I might give another view of this, I think what Michael's asking is for you to take a leadership role because you have the resources to do that. And when I look at the university like this, you have to understand that we as a community have created the perfect society. That's what a university is. It's the perfect world. There's no other universe like the university. And I think that you're beginning to get some blowback, or as Ward Churchill said, I think a long time ago, that there is no leadership, and now you're beginning to feel the impact, but you're also being chosen to take the point, Gunnar. You're out there moving the message for cutting, and you're showing up the vital statistics like education, $1.5 billion. 90% of that money goes to somebody's payroll. Unbelievable. It's just unbelievable, the degree of, it's as if we've gone tribal. And not special interest. This is way past special interest. It's tribal. Everybody's trying to protect feeding off the permanent fund dividend. And we're losing the mission here. So you know, I think the university needs to be addressing the Bernie people about a free university. How do you handle that? If you don't have the answer, I don't know how we don't have as a university.
Let me finish. I didn't follow your point. What do you mean a free university?
Well, what's happening here is we all sense a need for change and a lack of leadership. And Trump and Bernie Sanders, I think, represent that discontent on a very large scale. But we're pulled up in that, okay, whether we like it or not. So what happens here is if we take those people out there and use those as a reflection of what we need here, one of the strongest points I see with the Bernie Sanders people is they want an education which is hard to deny, and they want it damn near free. Well, you are the people as an institution. We have tooled and teched the university up to an unbelievable degree. I remember days when you had a little class downtown and you had people teach the university in the old days, I think it was called ACC or something. But my point is, instead of you taking the lead, what about ideas? What about consulting to the legislature? Because the legislature in the city, they're doing fear-based decisioning. Anytime you decide something on a fear-based, it's distorted in its outcome and approach. So you should be consulting them. You should be holding meetings because you have the facilities to hold large community meetings.
Well, so, Paul, for a start, that stuff's happened all the time at the university. There's all kinds of people talking here about ideas continuously, about and certainly both debating, you know, discussing ideas that are the current political issues in Alaska, or discussing ideas people have been talking about philosophically for 3,000 years. It's happening in these classrooms all the time and over at ICER, people are constantly talking about ways.
Where did I miss the meeting on taking my permanent fund dividend? I mean, where was that as a community wide with published notices in the newspaper and 6 hours long and bring the kids and sleeping bag? I don't see any major contentious, engaging, argumentative.
Well, for example, like, I mean, we've hosted all kinds of forums where people are discussing this. For example, ICER, the past 2 years, was a co-sponsor with Cliff's organization, the Alaska Common Ground, where they hosted big discussions that debated hotly this issue of sort of what's the permanent fund for, what's the permanent fund dividend, should it be considered for government or not. People are talking about this constantly, so I think the university is a source of ideas. The other thing is that as far as a free university, see, I'm really sympathetic to that. I like that. My kid's going to school, grad school in Germany. I said, because studying engineering. And I said, well, what's that cost? He goes, well, it's free. I said, free? They're going to let you go to for free? Right. He says, yeah, because it's free, just like K-12 education is free. And I said, well, that's a good deal. I like that. But what's happened I believe, unfortunately, across the country, is the whole country is going the other way. Universities that used to be nearly free, as state legislators have cut back on funding for those universities, they said, well, how are we going to pay for this? We'll raise tuition. And so tuition is going up all over the country. UA system's tuition is one of the lowest in the country, but it's being raised. So what should the university do? If we are fiscally responsible, we should raise tuition, make the students pay.
Well, maybe.
If we're fiscally irresponsible, they would ask the legislature to pay more. It costs the university more. It costs the state more. So, you know, I'm sympathetic to making education more accessible, but how does that affect the state's fiscal problem?
Well, I'm not sure what you mean by that.
Well, you said thought the university should be free.
Well, wait. My positions are hard positions, and this is yours, Mr. Chambers' time, so I'm trying to hold myself back here. I'm just trying to show you the diversity, just right here, the diversity of opinions and views.
But don't you think, Paul, that the diversity is a little reflective of the diversity in our society? And so diversity in our society is reflected a little bit, or maybe more than a little bit, in the legislature, which seems to leave nobody satisfied.
No, I didn't want say this real quick here. Mm-hmm. My position is it's so broken, it's unbelievable, it's somewhere between disgusting and corrupted. I've never seen the very foundations under which we would go to resolve the problems, to do problem resolution, is broken or corrupted or aberrant. It's unbelievable. So when you bring me into the picture, you know me, I'm going to show some slides when we get done here, but I want to start the whole system over. They're diverting capital to public employees' wages and compensation enumeration packages. That's why you don't have roads and bridges and everything else. The public sector has become omnipotent, and they're now sucking capital out, and they've forgotten what the free enterprise has done for this country. So I'm trying to hold back here with all this hard accusatorial talk, but I assure you I'm prepared to get in the battle here, but I'll let you guys get to...
Yeah. I've interrupted you.
I think you're hitting the nail on the head. Is we're going to the old institution of the university, going to the legislature, and playing their case why we should fund the university or K-12. And this is a resource-rich state. So what I'm saying is through university land grants, you wouldn't have to go to the university or go to the legislature and discuss that. I think that we have an opportunity here right now, and it's very important because we only have about 3 or 4 years of the pipeline, and then it is non-existent because there's not enough oil in it. So we better get more oil into the pipeline. And to me, to tie it to an educational endowment, and you're right, you hit the nail on the head, to watch the environmental educational factions fighting it out in Congress would be, I think, a wonderful thing. But I believe that the citizens of Alaska, what we owe to the citizens of Alaska, if this is a resource-rich state, that the university and pre-K through 12 and university should be one system and continuity. And let me give you a perfect example. My daughter is a 4.0 student at West High. She came to the university and she had to take remedial classes to get prepared to take the university classes. And she just graduated from USC with a 3.86. Now, why is it that she has to take remedial classes to prepare for UAA? Because of the incongruity of the weaving of the high school classes to the university. And what is it, 25% of the classes? Now, I know there's a lot of, because it's people that are older that come into the university, but 25% is remedial classes here at the university? I mean, to me, it's just like, I would much prefer for the university to solve their problems internally with an educational endowment than to have to go to the legislature and have a communication.
Well, I bet that you couldn't find anybody at the university that would disagree. We would.
But it's time.
Everybody here would love that endowment. Yeah, that'd be great.
Well, I think that we have a wonderful opportunity, and I'm again, I've been busy with so many other things that I'm going to start being active, coming here to the university, and I certainly appreciate this because it's the first opportunity that I've had to come to the university and to promote that, because I need to have some wind in the sails in that regard, because I think we're sitting on a wonderful situation where within the next year we could have a bill like that in Congress. And wouldn't that be wonderful?
See, you're a hero, Gunnar, I'm telling you. Heroes come from the damnedest places. I mean, go ahead.
I want to talk again about the budget here. You mentioned earlier a big mess is human health services. And in the state of Alaska, most people don't realize it, but our human health services is administered, or the IT work is done by Xerox machine or Xerox company. We have over 400 systemic unresolved errors in the Medicaid program in the state of Alaska, to the extent that our Medicaid program that exists before even any extension from the governor has not been certified by the federal government because it's such a mess. It has 400 unresolved systemic errors. We paid out $173 to $175 million last year in fraudulent claims, and we covered back, I think, $75 million. So $100 million just went where it went. So we have these situations in the state of Alaska where, and we have a Medicaid program, and then the governor, through administrative order, adds on an expanded Medicaid program to a Medicaid program that's completely broke. I mean, this is what's going on, you know, and the citizens need to be aware of this, that, you know, how can we sustain systems that are broken by throwing more money at them?
Really broken.
You know, so to me, it's like if you're not communicating with your legislators and paying attention and getting involved and getting educated, then you're just a citizen that's complaining about a particular special idea of your own. When you look at the whole picture, and I've been very, very fortunate to have so many organizations that feed me information. So because I get that, I get a tremendous amount of information coming to me, and so I start looking at the larger picture. And our larger picture is that if we don't fix this, the status quo is going to continue on. And all they're going to do is they're going to take the permanent fund dividend, or they're going to incorporate income tax or sales tax to continue to sustain that same system. You know, you have to look and say to yourself, okay, well, what's a better system? Well, certainly a better system is to develop the private sector here in the state of Alaska. And if we can't do it with the resources that we have available, we're crazy. You know, we're just absolutely crazy. We're lazy. This should be the richest state in the union. We should have the greatest university in America, bar none. You know, we have the resources. We just have to cradle those resources and advocate for them and take those resources and put them to good use. And the university system here should have, they should have an endowment that they you know, then the fight's internally here with what you do with education. And then we can start holding the university accountable for, I don't want them to just be filthy rich. I want the university to also be accountable to the people and to be evaluated. But in education, I will tell you right now, I've been in education, and the evaluation system, you take Baker Junior High over here, we have a system right now that we rate schools based on a 5-star system. Baggage Junior High is functioning at a 19% efficiency. 19%. They're 3 stars. They're rated 3 stars, and they're at 19% efficiency. Are you kidding me? No wonder people are upset about education. If we can't hold education accountable and get results, no wonder. And I paid the biggest price. I walked away from public education. I was a public educator, and I walked away. And the reason was because I didn't want to put up with that. And you know, and you might say, well, maybe you should have stayed there and fought that fight. But the bottom line is if we don't pay attention to how our efficiencies, and especially with education, our greatest resource isn't the oil on the North Slope. Our greatest resource is our children. And if we can't even pay attention, we're 49th in the nation with regard to education. Here in Alaska, we should be embarrassed. You know, and so to me, I have to wake up. I have to do something about it because I care about the citizens of Alaska, and I care about our children and the education that they're getting here. And I'm not saying here at the university, I'm saying here in Alaska is disgusting. We should be embarrassed.
On that note, Mr. Chambers, you had said that, and I understood that you were only one of
the 45
minutes. You'd only, Mr. Chambers, you talked about a 45-minute time limit.
Yes.
In terms of you having to leave. And I also think that it, so I think that it no later than 3:30, we should have a break to allow some change and maybe some slides for later.
Were you planning to allow some audience participation?
Absolutely. And I was going to do that right after we had this break.
Except the bookstore.
Makes more sense. So, Gunnar, do you have a response to Mr. Chambers? And then I thought we would have our break, and then we could come back with audience participation, and then perhaps some slides.
Well, I want to do some slides, too. So.
Sure.
And well, if you don't have to leave long, we can stick around, but I want to tie into Gunnar. I mean,
sure. My only point is a very general point, simply. I think that if citizens are discontent, as many citizens are discontent about many things, I think the only thing, I think that what they need to do is get involved in with the same, I don't know if everybody can get involved at the level you have, but you're the example of citizenship, true citizenship in a democracy where you say, I don't like what I see, I'm gonna get involved, I'm gonna learn the issue, I'm gonna push for the issue. And I've known a number of people in my life, you know, friends of mine and relatives who have also had that level of engagement, and that you discover two things. One, you can make a difference. You can make a real difference. And two, it's frustrating because it's slow and you don't always get your way and progress comes in fits and starts. And you're constantly obstructed by other people that are sort of working maybe for the opposite of what you're working for. But I think that what is dangerous to the country is if large numbers of people turn off and say, it's all just broken and they're all crooks and I'm not interested. That sets you up for tyranny of the left or the right.
Right.
So I think that the hope for the country, whether it's at the local level, the state level, or the national level, is to engage, become informed, and at the extreme, run for office or work with the people who are in office, and that's how you get there. That's a very general statement. It doesn't solve. That's the long, slow path towards fixing whatever it is that bugs you in some particular area. But I think that's the only choice. The only choice we have. The other choice, which really scares me, is when other people say we're just going to, you know, take matters in our own hand or have a revolution or whatever. What does that mean? It doesn't get you anywhere.
That's the kind of question that we can bring up when we come back here. And we need to have Mr. Kendall set up his slides and you, Dr. Knapp, set yours up. So let's take a 10-minute break until 20 minutes of four, and we'll be able to start. And we're going to start first with the audience participation, and then we're going to go with some slides. We're starting up again. Mr. Kendall, it looks like you have a presentation for us. Could you launch that?
Yes.
Go ahead.
Thank you. I'm honored to be here to do this, and I can't thank Mr. Dr. Knapp enough. And so, Gunnar, what I wanted to mention earlier here was when Mr. Chambers was here, I think that what we're seeing here is the status quo is no longer acceptable. And I think we're beginning to see that in multiple sectors of our society. And my position continues to be that Alaska is a very special place, and instead of us taking the leadership role and defining that, which we could do, we're not. We're broken, and we're now doing, many of our decisions are based upon fear-based reasoning. And when you do fear-based reasoning, you got a real problem just to begin with. So what happened was in our last meeting, which I found to be rewarding, and I can't thank you enough, Gunnar, I noticed there was no way to move the message because there was no presentation. And you are a good communicator at the very least. So I tried this morning to put together a rough presentation of just, but when I got into my presentation, I realized this is unbelievable, some of the complexities of the things we have woven these problems in, and it's going to take a lot of work to get them out. But I tried to make something up. I'm going to move very quickly because we only have about an hour's worth of time or 45 minutes. And then at the end, I'm going to throw in a cold fusion presentation very quickly to get it into the YouTube presentation for you to consider because you are with a large research body. So we start off here. My name is Paul Kendall. I'm just a simple person. Does this work? No? You have me on the mic, right? Okay. I'm just a simple person, but I've done a lot of things in my life, and I'm a free enterpriser and a bit of a rabble-rouser, I guess. But I love Alaska. I think it's a very special place, but something is wrong in Alaska. Something is terribly, terribly broken. And what really bothers me is what's coming in the future. There are things coming that are unbelievable, in my opinion. We're seeing some type of a metamorphosis, if you will, or an exoskeleton breakout of some kind here. And I think we're seeing it elsewhere, but in Alaska, I think it's very special. So I drew up this diagram. This is a Kendall diagram of evolving source economies. There are new economies coming, and I'm not sure what they are. Everything that we do from an economic study viewpoint needs to be reflected in a true and actual impact cost accounting manner. It needs to be viewed from an impact on our primary single family home and the life essential energies, services, not amenities. We have to turn all of our new designs for monitoring, measuring, and projecting to those sectors. The single family dwelling must be stabilized. It has to be stabilized immediately. Therefore, in my opinion, we need to start our system all over again. We can never, ever again allow the single-family home dwelling to be taxed for anything but material costs and essential needs projects. What that means is that in your taxing of your primary single-family dwelling, and you either own it or you rent it, from those two entities, everything's beget, begat, or begotten. I am never paying for a public employee's retirement, wages, therapy or anything else ever, ever again. We have to stop this and stop this right now because it undermines the society that we envisioned as a free American people, the free enterprise system. We can only allow our primary homes to be used to finance public sector. We can never allow it to be used to, I guess it says right there, we can never allow it to be used again for remuneration or compensations. Then a person would naturally ask, well, if you don't use your dwelling to get the property taxes on, how do you pay for school teachers or policemen or firemen? In my world, those people who flip the money, those people who just want to debt load my children with one debt load or loan after another, if you're going to flip the money, every time you flip that money, you're going to pay me 0.001 cents. And that's going to be our foundation for our public service sector. It doesn't mean we can't contribute more, but it means we have to hold it in check. Because the public service sector, in my opinion, has morphed itself into a form of extreme socialism. I think we're seeing communism up close and personal. And by the way, many of these problems are deep. These go into families. I watch those politicians down there. They're fearful of telling their aide they're going to cut their retirement plan. Well, I have children. We all have children. This is very deep what these problems are. But in the depth of these problems are great rewards for us Alaskans. So let me give you an idea what this is if you look here. Based upon each individual's needs, the primary dwelling, which is a single family home ownership, that's your foundation of all economies. That and whether you rent a unit, you either own that dwelling or you do not own it. From those two, everything is beget, begat, or begotten. But you cannot hold those two without the life essential energy needs and services. The life essential energy needs are five. There are no other essential services, in my opinion, needs. There are water, which is hydrogen, electricity, sewer, trash, and I have declared internet. I am staggered by what international communications is. This is unbelievable what this new realm or new paradigm is doing for all of us. Those are life essential services that we all agree to participate in and for our benefit. Now, if you go down below there, concerns again are the primary home taxes, material taxes only. I'm not paying for any more public employees' wages ever, ever again. We have to stop that right now. And those people who are public service sector, I'm not hateful. What I'm trying to tell you is you could benefit the most because you've had a good run. It's been a good time. You have a chance to cash out now, so to speak, and before we start this all over. You really can't lose, in my opinion. We also need to develop a standalone monetary system for the dwelling. And the reason for that is a lot of people are doing investment and gamemanship on the dwelling. The problem with predatory capitalism as opposed to free enterprise system is that it becomes predacious. It hunts for new opportunities. You cannot have that in the dwelling, in my opinion. That dwelling is the foundation, which we'll get into in a minute. The circle up here represents territorial. You have to have land, you have to have property to hold the dwelling. I haven't got my pointers. It's my first time. I just put this together this morning, but two entities are core foundations of all commerce. I cannot stress this enough, that everything you see out there, universities, churches, roads, bridges, it's all begotten from the dwellings. You and I live in the same area. Gunnar, you live in a nice area, and I rent a little place, and you come to me and say, hey, Paul, I'm tired of walking down and getting water. What do you say we put in a water pipe? I go, okay, well, Gunnar, I'm tired of walking for firewood. What do you say we put in a little road for firewood? Everything is begat from those dwellings. Everything, all commerce. All commerce is a product business, is a product, service, or solution. It goes nowhere without the dwelling. It is from those that everything travels. Oil, all of your oil is a resource that's owned by us, the people on the planet. It belongs to us. We convey to certain entities the opportunity to develop a resource that works in the best interest of our community, that's accountable and well-intended. The energy sector has gone off the edge, but things are moving very quickly. But here's my point. The oil would go nowhere if it didn't come to us in our home. Period. It goes nowhere. It goes to the home. I don't care where it goes. It goes to the dwelling. I don't care if you live in Nigeria or Brazil or where. You have to have a consumer. And yet we own that product. We have to separate out the life essential energies for the dwelling and stabilize those things.
Do you want to, I have some comments on the things you said. Do you want me to offer comments as you go to the slide, or do you want to get through all of it and then have me talk? I'm happy either way.
Well, why don't you let me go through it, and I'll back it up.
All right, okay. But
whatever works best for you, Gunnar.
No, that's right. No, sure.
Okay, because I've not done this before, and my knees are shaking up here. So what I tried to do is put a little color into this. Your number one priority is you either own or rent the dwelling and it needs essential services, energy is primarily in services. The service is the toilet. You gotta be able to flush the toilet. You gotta be able to pick up the trash, because if you don't, it'll impact another person's territory and disease. And you have to have the sewer, but the point is you also have to have electricity and energy. Okay, I think I'm repeating there. The second circle is what we call needs. These are not essential services. If you look up there in circle of needs, it's police, ambulance, fire, city clerks. You know, ladies and gentlemen, the schools, let me tell you something. You get a loving mother and father, and I'll tell you, I honestly think they could teach that child better than what we're seeing in school districts now. Now, not the college level. The college level continues to be an isolated institution of its own merits, but something is terribly wrong in that school district out there with the K-12, in my opinion. But anyway, so if you look at the circle of establishing priorities, which is what we're headed for, circle number three is your circle of wants and conveniences, which is different from needs. So you've got essential services, essential energies, and essential services, and you've got needs, and you've got wants and conveniences. Let's see, funding sources, fees, taxes, flipping the money, taxes, sin taxes, all public employees. Okay, let me move on here real quick. A review of the list of source of economic foundations. All economic foundations must reflect onto or in reference to its impact on the circle of economic forces foundation, primarily the single family home. Everything you do from now on should be reflected off of the stability of that single family dwelling, which holds the man or the woman or the individual that creates a family and the values and the mission. Electricity is essential energy needs. And by the way, I'm going to show you here in a minute, there are technologies that are bursting. It's just spooky what we're seeing out there now that the public's not aware of. It appears that energy is going to be decentralized. And if you take away energy from monetizing up the dollar and using it as an economic stimulus, these are models we've never been to before. If we stabilize the home now, it doesn't matter what economies happen, because our families will be warm and they'll be energy sufficient. And if you have energy, you can tool up, tech up, light up, arm up, transport, communicate, grow food. It's all about energy, setting God to the side for the moment. Number two, electricity's essential energy needs are about to become decentralized. Three, life essential energy needs, water, electricity, communication. I think some of this is repetitive. The primary single family dwelling property taxes, I'm trying to repeat these to stress these. essential services, outside foundation circle. Okay, that's just a repeat. Revenues, true and actual impact. Let's see. Okay, I can't stress enough true and actual impact cost accounting methodologies. We can have no longer have tricked up verbiages or tricked up economic designs. Everything has to be real and true and impact, because everything seems to have a causation or an effect. Public employees, revenue taxes, funding ideas, okay. We're on the verge, in my opinion, of a decentralized power. The new technologies coming online appear to be paradigm shifting. It's unbelievable. We need to discuss, prepare for this as an open and participatory society, community, state, and families. And I think this is where I'm harping, and I'm hitting heavy on the university, because of your vast amount of resources and your intellectual capacity to reason these things out, just to see if they're fair or unfair. And again, some of the things that disappoint me the greatest are we're having these very divisive discussions that impact each of us, because we've all been feeding off the free money. But in reality, what really bothers me is we could lead the rest of the world by reconstructing our Alaskan society overnight, and nobody wants to deal with that. And the implications are huge. I mean, this is bigger than the oil pipeline, in my opinion, from the old days that may be here. Now, I want to show you something from statistics. I'm not a statistics guy. I'm a guy that when things are wrong, you repair them. It doesn't take, I don't think, a college degree always to do that stuff. But these were some things I got out of some of the blogs on the newspaper. State, and according to the 2008 census, and I think this lady's name was Kathy Kieran I got this from, but there's 62,644 people statewide, 48,124 were full-time, 224 million is the net monthly wages, which is $2,688,000,000 per year. Facilities, yada, 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 14,000 were part-time employees paid $15,000 a month. More than 50% of those 62 employees were employees of higher education. So education or higher. So you can't, I don't see how the university can stay out of this fray. This is the Kathleen Kieran here. I think it's pretty much the same repeat here. See total number of employees, I'm gonna move past that. Now this is something I got into this the other day, just yesterday, but I threw it together as quickly as I could. I called the PERS and TERS, and out of PERS and TERS, there's 44,931 people that are drawing a retirement check. This doesn't count medical or anything else. And if you're a public employee, which is PERS, your average check is $1,500 a month. If you're a teacher, it's $2,800 a month. And then in addition to the retired people of 44,931, they have an active pay-ins participation in the PERS and TERS of 45,926. When you look at the totality of that, of 91,000 people in the state, that's unbelievable. 91,000 people I'm giving money to, everything they ever really need, cost of living, everything I'm giving to them, and we haven't even gotten the financials to the health and human services. You cannot sustain the consumption. The parasitical nature has become predatory. And if we don't deal with this as an entire community who has the same moral values and the same love connections, we're all gonna go off the edge on this. And the funny thing is about chaos is everyone always thinks it's never gonna happen to them. It's always gonna happen to somebody else. So we're all gonna suffer. In other words, these are throwdown numbers that may not be entirely correct. My understanding is that PERS and TERS has $20 billion. If you divide that by the 100,000 people, that's $222,000. And all of that money came from our shared resources money. It's part of my money. And Gunnar, you know how I feel about you. You have a disproportionate amount of my money. And in addition to that, if I understood them correctly, the state still owes $1.4 billion. I'm not sure. Some of these facts are suspect and should be. These are hard, rough notes that I made that sometimes I put down as a reference point. Many of these people that I see have been using their children as a means of revenue generation. This is terrible. This is disgusting. What they've done is they've folded them all in, and they've turned the education system, primarily the lower one, K through 12, they've turned it into an industry. This is unbelievable. I mean, it's just they've constructed one industry after another to be able to get more funding, to get more votes, and all of this starts from the single family dwelling. The single-family dwelling is the source of all your revenue, the stability of your societies. I tell them even sexual preferences and work ethics, everything come from the dwelling, which is argumentative. But the point is this, that the school districts, the very thing that we held to be sacrosanct with the things we love the most, has turned into a Pied Piper. They're gender neutering. They're throwing in multitudes of classes of various degrees of re-education. They have forgotten the mission, which was to teach that child to be socially interactive, and at the same time to hold discipline so that the challenges that come to them, they can be prepared to handle that. I am staggered by the fact that since 1977, our leadership, the status quo, those people, they have drawn down 70% plus of that money. Unbelievable. And then to come to this time and want to take the permanent fund dividend to the people, this is just staggering, absolutely staggering. All right, now.
I just want to sort of point out, I think there's less than a half hour left, it's about a half hour left. And there's three or four things we want to talk about. In terms of finishing your presentation, whatever questions or comments Gunnar might have, and then there's audience participation, and then you talked about a cold fusion. So I want to talk about that in terms of a half hour context.
All right, I'll rush it up here. All right, what this comes down to is we've lost the mission. The mission, ladies and gentlemen, was for our people, our children, to be more free so that they might explore the wonders of it all in a more safe manner. 100 billion galaxies, 1 trillion stars, 2.8 million species on the planet, and my children have to fear walking down the street. This is just unbelievable. So when you have a failure of your mission like this, you lose your foundations. When you lose your foundations, you have to reestablish your priorities. What the hell are your priorities? And we need to argue these out. And I go to undeniable positions. One is your state of being, the next is individual free will, and then moral foundations comes in there, and then the life essential energy needs. You have to have the life essential energy needs for that dwelling, and we can no longer allow the gas, oil, utility companies to come into those things as a predatory, disruptive. They're disrupting our fundamental foundations with their profit-oriented by multitudes of other, by being non-profit. Okay. Primary dwelling essential needs. The next new major technology breakthrough is expected to be producing clean and high density energy. I'm going to show you some slides here very quickly, but they're now talking. And let me make this real quick here. It isn't just me. It's the data has to stand for it. The Saudis just set up a $2 trillion fund to break away from fossil fuels. Bill Gates 3 weeks ago made the comment, this is his comment, I predict within 15 years we'll discover new energy which will change the world as we know it. Bill Gates said that, I didn't say that. Norway just passed a bill, no more vehicles in their country after 2020 unless they're electric vehicles. It's Tesla Electric, there's only about 200,000 electric vehicles I think in the world or something like that. Tesla Electric just had an order for 226,000 EVs in 2 days. They're now at 325,000 counting. And Tesla are little guys compared to the big players out there. So finally, we're about to understand energy like we've never seen before. And part of that, believe it or not, is about hydrogen. I come back to Mr. Hydrogen. But keep this in mind. You are a hydrogen fuel creature. Every one of those 2.8 million species on the planet is a hydrogen fuel creature. And your home has hydrogen, and that stuff we have now come to realize is unbelievable in its energy containment, which you're about to see here very quickly. And by the way, in this note here, these are little facts I throw down, but my understanding is that oil companies are pulling out of big fields, the banks are pulling out of big oil fields, and they're moving into infrastructure and new technology for processing. The pension funds and the government are moving into the big oil. We think they're about to lose their butts. In the meantime, they say the new frontier is information. Information is going to cost, and so these are just relevant points. Too many people are gaming the system. We need to go back to first in time, first in line. I understand that. I respect that. I expect the recognition of people who contribute to our community. Alaska is unique, except our political system is terribly, terribly broken. New source economies. I'm going to close with this one. The rest are just. I cannot, if anybody doesn't understand this, they need to tell me about this, but from the dwelling, it is all begotten from the dwelling. The single family home that you own and the rental, from those two entities, everything is flows from those. And you need to have this at an argumentative moment. And all right, now, Gunnar, if you want to ask me some questions about that, and then I'm going to go to the cold fusion so I can work it in here.
Before that, I think Gunnar should ask some questions. Then I'd like to get some audience participation. We said we'd have some. So, Gunnar, why don't you make some questions or comments, then we'll go to audience participation. And that would involve coming up to this microphone.
Do you want me to bring back the slides or just?
I'll just make a few observations, Paul, from some points.
All right.
Well, you're talking about a lot of stuff, which I applaud. We tend, as we go along, to sort of think, well, the world works in a certain way, and that's just the way it is, and so we tend to think in marginal terms of, we might adjust the way we live in some small way, but in fact, it's important to think about the big picture, the way the whole society works, and is it working right, and how should we change it? That said, I would just offer a few comments. First, this is my own personal observation. You said we're on the verge of communism. I don't think we're nowhere near on the verge of communism. I've spent time in communist countries, the old Russia, old Soviet Union before. I've seen that place. That was horrible. I had secret police following me around. The shops were empty, nothing to buy, people depressed, a drab, horrible society, not to mention the terrible history of that place, people getting rounded up by the millions. And taken away to prisons and shot and so on. It's reasonable people have a lot of gripes about this country, a lot of gripes about things they don't like, but there is no comparison with communism. I mean, that's my observation based on what I've seen.
I think we're beginning to see the beginning of it, quite frankly, so I would take some, we're definitely going to the third world country status, in my opinion.
But, yeah, well, that's a different issue.
But I think we're seeing the beginning of it. But I will agree with you. The extremity of the state is not quite.
Second, a lot of people have at various times said what I think you've said. Look, there's a few things we need to focus on. Single-family dwelling and what's essential in that, and you listed some things: water, energy, and so on.
Five.
Yeah.
Toilet, water,
mm-hmm.
electricity.
Right.
And internet.
I just add the following observation: when you think about it, one, I'm not sure if those are the most essential things. For example, you didn't mention food, and you didn't mention health care. Medicine and so on. And when I'm sick, I tend to think of
those are not some, life. Those are not life essential.
Food strikes me as kind of life essential.
Well,
my point is that it's a little tricky to say that it's these particular things because one, as you point out, when technology changes, and you gave the example of the internet. If you'd said some poor Rip Van Winkle wandered in here, and you say, here are the five essential things, and the internet, and you go, what? What's this new essential thing? So I think it's a little tricky to pick out any particular set of things and say, those are critical, and these we're going to put in a special category, and everything else is less.
Gunnar, just a second. This is, in essence, what I'm talking about right now. You should be holding a week-long discussion on the essential services and what are they. And I'm prepared to have that battle. I'm prepared to have that argument.
But I think a lot of people, for example, would say what's essential is food.
Well, you're being too...
Food is, for example. What do you think those... We're getting some real live examples if you read the horror stories coming out of Syria, place where they've got these cities that have been shut down by war for like 5 months, and they're interviewing the people that are escaping from there. What didn't they have, and what did they miss most? And they weren't talking about internet. They're talking about the kids are starving.
I can come back to that, so, but if you have other points,
okay,
once you get...
Okay, so just a few more things. You mentioned the single-family dwelling and the need to provide these essential things to the single-family dwelling, but arguably, our places of work are just important, and they use these things too. Like, you know, the factories that produce the stuff we have, they need energy, they need water. We don't just operate and live and need stuff in our homes. Our society is bigger than that. The things we need fuel for, we need energy for, we need water for, we need sewage for. So I think you need I get that where we live is critical. It's not even, you know, I spend less than half my day at my dwelling. And all these other places where I am, they need all these things too.
Well, if I might, Gunnar, and I don't want to, I feel I'm...
I'm almost done. Okay, so why don't I just finish my comments and then I'll be done. Actually, I think those were the... Why don't I just leave it at that?
Let me finish this up first.
Less than 20 minutes left.
Let me finish this up first. I'm not denying those things, but what happens when you have a failure of the mission, you have to reprioritize. Gunnar, your job is not there if you don't have a home. If you think you're going to roam the woods and build a fire and have a job, you're wrong. You have to get into the heartfelt discussion, establish the priorities. And when you leave the room, everybody has to agree. They have to be undeniable. So I'm not denying those other things. What I'm trying to do is get us back on the mission. You cannot eat the money. 2.8 million species, nobody eats the money. Never have, never will. We have lost the mission because we've all been coveting the money. We're all guilty. And when you do that, you have to reestablish your priorities. So I'm not denying those things that you're saying. They're just a longer discussion to prove my point or to disprove it.
Okay.
All right. And then I still want to get the fusion in, but I'm with Cliff, how do you...
You know, we promised, I think, some public participation. If you...
Well...
Anybody want to ask a question in the audience? If you do, you can come up to the microphone now.
Great. That's a no. Time's up. No.
I'm not seeing in our giant audience.
You're giving away too much time. Somebody's going to get up if you keep that,
okay.
Keep that time.
All right. Mr. Paul D. Kendall, you want to show your cold fusion.
Yes. And okay. And okay. I want you to keep this in mind now.
How long is that? Because like I said, we have just 15 minutes.
I think an hour and 20 minutes.
Okay. Well, we only have 15 minutes.
No. I'm just going to, when they say shut it, we're all friends here and Gunner's in charge and we'll just shut it down. We want here, but I want to get this in. This is an old presentation. It's nearly four years old. It's come a long ways, and ladies and gentlemen, you can't begin to imagine that the names are now involved in this unbelievable historical event that's going. But in the meantime, they think they've discovered fusion. It's called low-energy nuclear reactions, and it comes from hydrogen. And it first broke out in early 2012. And I contacted these people, had them come here, the university, the engineering, and somehow it didn't work out, and they went on. In the meantime, 4 years later now, it is unbelievable what's coming. I'm just going to show you a rough idea of an old slide here, but you need to, my position is if we convert, if we get on board, if we get a research team together, and Gunnar, I cannot stress enough, this is not for the physics department. This is for the little people. If we put a research team together and go see these people, I think we could convert overnight, and our children would have a place in history to die for. This is a very big one. Now, I'm going to run this real quick. These are pipelines through America that most people don't see. These are pressure pumping stations. This is about Alaska's future, what direction we're supposed to take, what is coal fusion. These are some of the projects we had underway, I mean, several years ago, the Susitna Dam, the Power Belt, the Permanent Fund. Everything is going to be impacted by this new discovery of fusion coming online. It's hydrogen fusion. What is it? Who has it? When is it coming? What will it do? What can we do? This is what we're used to in normal terms of heat. The blue flame is the hotter flame. We're used to that type of heat. In this type, this is atomic bombs. This is the Fukushima thing. This is the tokamak you hear about, which is a plasma field inside of a magnetic field. And they thought fusion was going to be it was going to be 100 lasers. This is what you first heard about cold fusion in 1989. They now believe they did discover it, but they ruined these men's careers. This is just some basic date. This is the vessel here. This vessel is 6.5 centimeters, about the size of a D-cell battery in a flashlight. It has a built-in water jacket. They add hydrogen and nickel, and when they do, it goes to 200, 400 degrees Celsius, about the temperature of a boiler in your house. That little thing will run 6 months nonstop, full bore, on a fifth of a nickel. Unbelievable. And when they add the nickel to the hydrogen, the nickel transmutates into pure copper. That's the byproduct. And by the way, this not only generates all that heat, this little thing here, for 6 months on a fifth of a nickel, they're also predicting 5 to 10 kW in thermal electric. That's enough to run a small home, maybe three small village dwellings. It's about 6.5 centimeters. This is not complicated. This is the first one. It's 4 years old. These are four of them here. The one that's all, I need a pointer here, but this thing with the tinfoil is insulated. And then this is a cross-section of what it looks like. The vessel is not the IP. They expect this to be the most black-marketed item in the history of mankind. It's just stainless steel, copper tubing, some lead, some thermocouplers. You can make it in your garage. It is not the intellectual product, not the IP. This is what it looks like inside. The vessel is about the size of a D-cell battery and a flashlight, but you know this little red thing, that's the reactor. This is what it looks like from the side. They took that heat and put it into what we call a heat exchanger, like a radiator in the house. They insulated it. This is what your new home unit would look like, which will supposedly generate all the electricity you'll ever need. They took these units here, each one of them, they put them in a Connex container, and they made a megawatt of heat. And that megawatt will heat about 70 full-blown homes, okay? Now, I'm trying to get through that. I'm going to get through this very fast. I'm just trying to give you an introduction. The U.S. Navy, we think, bought this one. Then Siemens came along, yada, yada, yada. And now they're predicting oil was 150-year fuel. They think this new discovery is a 10,000-year fuel discovery. They're predicting that they can penetrate 25% of the public with these vessels in a year. These are staggering. This came from, a Motorola scientist. But the magnitude you can see from this one here, I forget which one, it was called the singularity theory. But it's unbelievable where this is headed to. Now, I told you about the other one would run 6 months on a fifth of a nickel to generate the 5 to 10 kW. They had a split up in the company, and this company claims they can generate 45 kW, and it'll run a year and a half without a recharge. And the unit looks something like, this is what it looks like. The hydrogen's in the blue tank, and the little vessel is a little chrome thing in the back there, here. And this is the size. So you can see that and then another company came along called Brillouin, which is with Stanford Research Institute out of Berkeley area. And they claim they can run a boiler in Nome, Alaska for 3 to 5 years on a Coke bottle of water at 135 degrees Celsius. That's their words, not mine. Run a boiler in Nome, Alaska for 3 to 5 years. And then they went on to say they brought that same operation to Berkeley, they could run it for 15 to 20 years. And by the way, Canada brought these people out of Greece and put them up in Vancouver and gave them a blank check. They also claim they can replace coal-fired power plants. I'm trying to get down to some more. Now, NASA came along, and they now think they could use this instead of some nasty thermal, some of the radioactive stuff they use for all their missions. They're also claiming that they can jump out of the parking lot due to the energy density of this new discovery, and they can actually mine asteroids as they walk over. And what I'm trying to give you a scope of, we've never encountered, and mankind has never seen this kind of energy before. It's unbelievable. And the names are involved in it, they're getting bigger every day, and we think it's going to breach this June. Let's see, I think I'm going to probably let it go there. Oh, I want to show you one more thing. I want to read this to you. This is an 8-page report. It's a DIA document, Defense Intelligence Agency. Now, I hunt the data is what I do. I've been tracking it now for nearly 4 years. I capture everything I can about it, pictures, the players, everything. This is a Defense Intelligence Agency document. I don't know, can you read that, Gunnar? Is that?
Yeah, I read it fine, yeah.
Have you read it already, or should I read it?
I'm most of the way through.
Okay. When you get done with that, I want to show you just a couple more one-sentence things here. They're referring to this as disruptive technology. Their words are that the scientists around the world are now reporting paradigm-shifting results, okay? Previously thought not possible. This is unbelievable, ladies and gentlemen. It's truly something out of, I'll read you a comment here in a minute. Now, if you just read the bold print there, the body of research has produced evidence that nuclear reactions may be occurring under conditions not previously believed possible. Then if you go to another one here, this is what they think they've discovered. They estimate there's up to 10 million times the energy per chemical unit of mass than anything on the planet. This is staggering. It's just staggering, okay? And the reason it is because no one has been talking about it. All right, now I'm gonna shut these are people around the world. The public doesn't seem to be aware of this. These are corporations we think are gonna jump first with this new discovery. They're gonna leave our dwellings, they're gonna abandon our dwellings and go for the new energy as quick as they can. So we really have to bring our communities, we have to sanctify these dwellings, in my opinion, and make them a very special part of our economies. Let's see, I think I'll shut that down there. And then that concludes my presentation. I wanted to get those into the, just for the general public to see, okay?
Okay.
Now, my position is, Gunnar, that if we go get some of these things and bring them here, that we could convert to the first fusion-based society in the history of mankind. And Gunnar, every corporation in the world would say, get your butt up there. I don't care if you sleep in a cardboard box. We need to know what products fail, what products are viable, what's not. And if we can hold on to our $50 billion dividend fund, so to speak, in essence, our investors would see the new frontiers of investment. They'd be way ahead of the rest of the world. But more importantly, our people would have greenhouses. With this kind of energy, you can live underwater. With this kind of energy, you come to me for taxes, honey, get the kids, I'll get the power pack. Your whole society will be reconstructed overnight, and it doesn't care who you are. It doesn't care if you're 501c3 or what your gender is or what your degree is. You're either going to roll with this or you're not going to roll. And if you don't roll with it, you're going to miss something that we've never seen before. And if you think they're going to wait out there no one's going to wait on this. This thing is going to be mercurial. And they think they can mass produce these things. Now, in closing, the slideshow I showed you was 4 years ago. It was 2 to 400 degrees Celsius, 5 to 10 kW in thermal electric, and it'll run 6 months on a fifth of a nickel. Ladies and gentlemen, right now, they guaranteed 6 times the energy out you put in, and now they're in a big lawsuit, the rumor has that they're producing 50 times the energy out that you put in. They're at 1,400 degrees centigrade, and they're predicting 250 kW in thermal electric generation, and it's bigger than all that. And this is where we're at now. This thing is beginning to go someplace we've never seen before. So if we institute now, Gunnar, we end up getting the revenues from the fossil fuel, which I think we're beginning to see peak fossil fuel demand. It's just an intuitiveness I have, but if we roll now, we'll have the residual fossil fuels, we'll have a new society, and we'll have to have Trump put up a wall because they'll want to come up here from all over the world. We'll have the first university in the history of mankind that introduces a fusion-based society in the economies. Everyone here will have a power plant supply you'll never worry about energy again. The Eskimos will sit in greenhouses and talk to the creatures how they used to eat them. I mean, the dynamics of this are huge, just unbelievable. And where are my people? They're hunkered down in Juneau in secret talks where we can't watch them be foolish or ask stupid questions. And the reason they're there, Gunnar, is because you drafted them a presentation point platform under which they could move their message, and their message is to maintain the status quo, and that is the very last thing we need for a brave new world that our children are going to live in that we probably not. I mean, it's unbelievable what we're seeing out there now.
But let me ask this at this point. What you're suggesting is something that, if it's true and if it happens, it will absolutely transform the world, right?
Absolutely. Bigger than that. But okay. We can't go there.
And so, and that would be like the whole world, That's just Alaska.
It's bigger than that.
Right, and so what's stopping it from, if this, and especially if it comes out in a year, what's, you can buy the first one, or you can sell the first 100,000 and become a billionaire. What's stopping it?
Well,
and what are you asking the state to do? See, I'm basically, I think I'm in agreement with a lot of conservatives and libertarians. I want to get the government out of things, and in particular, get the government out of the economy. And I don't want the government chasing things. I want people with good ideas and new technologies to bring them on. Sell me invent an iPhone and I'll be there to buy it. Invent one of these things that can heat my home with a Coke bottle of water. I'm there to, I want it for my cabin. I want it right away.
I say if
the technology's there, let her rip.
Well, Cliff, did you say you had a question?
I'm saying that there's only 3 minutes left.
Oh,
here.
Okay. Well, we can stretch it out a little bit, right? Here's the point. Your question is a fair question, okay? Pulitzer Prize winner on YouTube says that the silence is deafening. The public seems to be disconnected. There seems to be some kind of a transition that occurs, windows of opportunity or transformation or metamorphosis that some of us see and some of us don't. That's where leaders come in at. I've been places. I went to the Department of Revenue, talked to two of their boys for an hour and a half, and they got up and said,
Alaska Department of Revenue have to do with the fabulous technology that can heat your home? Why does that have anything to do with them?
Well, because...
Bill Gates, when he invented the iPhone or whatever, he didn't go to the Department of Revenue and say, let me revolutionize how people communicate with each other. It just happened. I mean, they did it, the private sector did it all themselves.
No, I agree with that. Everything you said is factual, and I agree with that, but you begged the question, then you answered it. What I'm trying to tell you is that the answer to that is I went to the Revenue Department because they have the most to lose. You have to understand that what we're about to see, ladies and gentlemen, is an evolutionary leap in mankind's understanding of energy. If you put God to the side for the moment, you're about to find out that everything is about energy. Everything. I don't care what it is, it's about that. The irony is that when you get done with that discussion, you'll come back to the God thing with a fervor, because once you connect the energy, it acts as a vehicle under which you connect everything else. My point is this. I went to the Revenue Department because they have billions of dollars. I tried to explain to them, your models, your predictions, your actions, we need to put together a special team. We need to go talk to these people. We need a war room. We need to see how fast this thing's going to spread and where it's going to spread, because it's going to change every sector. Every economy is going to move to this thing very quickly. What I showed you here when it launches, which was supposed to be this June of this month, it's supposed to be out, we think it's going to come out that earlier by the end of the year, 4 years later, by the way. But the point is that when it does, we don't know what sectors it's going to hit first, whether it's going to be industrial or residential. But all of our economies, your oil could fold up overnight here, is what I'm saying. I don't want to take the negative view of the loss. I'm trying to tell them that, wait a minute, if we get these and put them in, if we get 200 of them, put them in each of the villages, the natives will see a leap in their society that we've never seen before.
Well, as soon as it comes out, I'm sure every village is going to want to buy one.
But you can't wait. But you can't wait, because that's going to be after the fact. That's what I'm trying to.
Well, what it means, let's say
you have research.
Let's say in July, they say grand opening sale. This, miraculously cheap energy, fuel your village. I'm sure that, if we don't buy the first batch, we'll buy the second or third to power all our villages. But I'm not going to buy it till I see somebody else got it working.
No, but what?
How are we doing, Cliff, with time? We are going to have to. Pardon?
We're at 4:30.
So I think what we should do, Paul, is why don't you? I've had a chance to comment. Why don't you take a minute or two to. Say some closing remarks, and then we do have to stop, and we have to let our video people go.
shut this off, or?
Yeah, and you can hit the, you can turn the lights on if you want.
Okay. Well, thank you, Gunnar. I finally got to give a presentation. I gave that to the LIO a long time ago, just a real brief one.
I mean, I think it's cool. It'll be amazing if it happens. I just don't. I don't quite follow what the state should do. And my own reaction is, I'm sick and tired of the state government spending lots of money on ideas that are somebody's. Somebody's people come and tell the state government, we got to turn Alaska into the breadbasket of the world and make a lot of farms, and then that, well, it didn't work. Then they all these schemes, they want to spend our precious money, and so I'd sort of say, I'm all for great things happening and new technology, but I don't want the government to get involved in it. That's kind of what I
feel. I'm with you on that. But there are fundamental broken foundations in Alaska, and they need to be repaired. You have to move the capital. You have to get that capital up here where we can engage and hold it accountable and get angry and set in the whatever the bleachers up there, and I forget what they call it now. But when you beg these questions about when it comes, you have to understand that everything seems to be at some type of a, not a tipping point, it seems to be some type of a of an evolution of some time that we're seeing here. Your money is about to go off the edge. I'm not sure that money's going to be there. All of these premises under which they're going to tax us and invest in a permanent fund dividend, stock market could crash tomorrow. All of that's illusionary. But if you can bring heat into my home, I can't stress this enough. It's about energy. If you have energy, you can tool up, tech up, light up, arm up, transport, communicate, grow food. It begs a whole new society. And you make it sound like it's just going to roll out in Walmart tomorrow. And what I'm trying to tell you is that the unknown model under which this is going to be introduced into our society appears to be mercurial. It's going to move in all directions at its own will. And if we don't get an advanced team out there now, we're going to lose because your expectations of a model are not going to be there. But if a university, if you gathered your research, when I look at your research that you have, Gunnar, it's unbelievable. You could gather those people up, we could put a 20-man team together, we could take $100 million, and we could line up having this as the first university in the history of the planet to actually participate in the new fusion-based economy, along with an oil company as a partner.
Well, okay, I think you've effectively stated your case, and with that, I think our...
I really appreciate, thanks to everyone for coming, and we're done now.